So this past week, I got a book from Mary O'Malley. It was a gift. It wasn't actually a gift. She just gives me books and loans them to me, and I don't return them, so I consider them gifts. And it's funny because this gift was called, you know, The Abundance Project. And obviously she thinks I have a hoarding issue or I need more affluence in my life, probably because I don't return her gifts to her. but I will. I will return that gift. But so I'm looking at this book, The Abundance Project, and on it says, like, you know, more love, more happiness, more health, more vitality. And I'm like, yeah, okay, yeah, this is good stuff. And I open up the book, and the first chapter title I see is Substance Abuse. And I'm like, substance abuse? What the hell does substance abuse have to do with prosperity? So I'm thinking, oh, is this idea of substance abuse like our addiction to just having more and being more and doing more and not actually allowing ourselves to be in the flow of affluence? And I thought, wow, what a clever twist for this writer to come up with the concept of substance abuse being a block for affluence. I guess I'll tell you the joke before the end, because I was going to share it at the end, but the truth is I read it wrong. It was the substance of abundance, and I was like, but I went on this long tangent. And I went rolling with it, and I gave this whole talk, and then I looked back in the book, and I was like, oh, he wasn't saying that at all. But anyway, while I was in this misinformed state, I started thinking about substance abuse. And, you know, substance is the real, or is the tangible, it's the physical, it's the substance that we're made out of, the bodies, the things, the solid presence of things. This is substance. And it made me think, are we in abusive relationships with the form? And the truth is, we are. Every time we judge something as imperfect, we are abusing that person, place, thing, or ourselves. So we are all in these substance abuse relationships without even being aware of it most of the time. And this type of substance abuse could be the very thing that prevents us from experiencing that greater flow. The idea of abuse means to misuse something, to mistreat something, to use something in a way that it's not, its purpose is not designed for. And so to misuse something is the lack of care, right? And as Dave said, we're here to care for each other. We're here to care for the things that are within our jurisdiction. I like to say that anything that's underneath your nose, you're here to care for that. And when we do care for things, we do ignite that greater affluence in our life, because what is cared for grows and thrives. And what is abused, it cowers and it shrinks back. And so we have the keys to the kingdom right here in figuring out how we could actually have a greater idea of affluence in our life. So the question is, are we dealing with substance abuse? Most addicts do not think that they have a problem. You know, most addicts, they just don't think, they're like, no, I have great tolerance for pain and discomfort and disease and tragedy. Like, this is my life and it's all good. I can deal with this. This is the way it's supposed to be, you know? When normal is sick, sick is normal. When stressful is normal, normal is stressful. But, you know, when we accept these things as normal, they become like the glass ceiling. They become the box that we conform to. So maybe the keys to abundance is the ability to care, to begin to really move into radical and impeccable care for ourselves, for the things that we have. I like to think that care is a great fertilizer for greater abundance. And so if there's a place in your life that's feeling stagnant or not growing, the simple cure could be to take care of it. You know, if your abundance, if your prosperity is looking so sick that you don't even want to look at it, that's the thing that you got to put your nose to. If your physicality is gone way out of whack, like, that's the thing you got to put your nose to. And all of us have a call to greater love, and you know exactly what that is, and we all have something to care for in a greater way. And there's no shame in it. You know, that just happens to be our classroom at this particular time. A Course in Miracles says that in order to have a healthy relationship with all things, we're called to ask, what is the purpose? What is the purpose for this thing? And also it asks us to say, like, I don't know what anything is for, so let me come without what I think the purpose is, but let me come with an open mind and a healthy degree of curiosity so I can really look at this situation with compassion and without judgment. So there's this Rumi quote. People quote this quote all the time, and they only get halfway through it. And Rumi says, you know, there's a place beyond all right and wrong, a field, I'll meet you there. And we love that, right? Beyond all right and wrong, like, let's get to that open field where we can just be with each other and let's meet there and then see what solutions arise, what creative solutions arise. But as long as I'm saying you're wrong and you're saying you're wrong, we're going to have conflict and not an open field. But the other part of Rumi's quote is, when the soul lies down in the grass, the world is too full to talk about. It's like he's asking us to move into the experience beyond all the thinking of right and wrong. The experience of, like, have you gotten yourself to that beautiful field where you just let yourself lay down and experience the magnificence of your life? Well, oftentimes we're not looking at those places that are beautiful. Well, all places are beautiful and magnificent, you know, but do we allow ourselves to experience that? We did that last week when we looked at a chair. You know, we all just looked at a chair and said, what is its purpose? And let me see this chair as it is. But even when we have that moment where we give each other a hug, like, are we with each other? We're having our interactions throughout the day. Are we really, like, with each other? Can we get with each other? Can we lay down on that grassy field with each other and really take each other in and take the experience in? Because everything in our experience is begging to be recognized. It's begging to be seen and heard and experienced. It's, you know, Oprah Winfrey said on this thing that was listened to her this past week, she said, without exception, every time on my show when I've cut the camera, from a man whose son was killed in a gang, to Beyonce, to everyone who came on her show, said the same exact thing after the camera turned off. Was that good? How was that? Everything is calling to be praised. Everything is saying, am I good enough? Am I good enough? Am I good enough? Like, that's a universal disease. And so what would it be like if we, like, went around and said, you're good. Like, I appreciate you. I appreciate you for everything you're doing. There was another quote that I saw on Facebook this past week where, you know, we have this addiction for saying, I'm sorry I'm late, you know, I'm sorry that I didn't show up this way. And instead to change that vocabulary into, thank you. Thank you for being so generous that I could show up late and you're not gonna hold it against me. Thank you for letting me be a complete mess in front of you and for you to be able to be here and hold the high watch. That gives our friend the praise instead of there's something that went wrong here and let's all commit to a broken scenario and judge each other. We're waking up to flipping the conversation. So when A Course says ask for what everything is for, it uses an example as a telephone. It says you think that a telephone's purpose is to contact that person who's not in your physical vicinity. But what you never ask is what the real purpose is. And the purpose underneath that is always the question, is this for love or fear? Am I using this item for love or for fear? Am I using it to condemn and control, or am I using it for extension and for appreciation? And that's a simple question. And in the answer to that question, we can annihilate so much of the ego and so much of the BS, and that can help us to stay on course. Here, all fear comes from the belief in scarcity. All of it comes from the belief in scarcity. There's not enough. You're not enough. I'm not enough. We're not enough. This is not working out for us. All of it comes from a belief in scarcity, as opposed to a belief in appreciation. Appreciation adds to. It says yes and to things. From the illusion of scarcity blooms disease, and specifically the disease of wanting. And that's why we have this substance abuse, because we're wanting. You know, we feel like there's something empty within us, and we want to fill that hole. And there's a line that says, the Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. But do we believe that? No, we go on the mad rampage with the ego saying, oh, I want this, and I want that, and I want this, and I want that, and I don't have, and I don't have, and I don't have. As opposed to leaning back and saying, that is, you know, not right. Right there, I was like at the cliff, and I like pulled back. That's not correct. You know, that's not correct. The Lord is my shepherd. My Lord is my source. It is in love with me. It delights in bringing me the kingdom, the buffet. All that I could ever need or want is supplied to me. And I will not dabble in the mad ramblings of an ego. Like, I just will not do it. And I will be impeccable with that truth. And I will be impeccable with it for myself and for you. And in that way, we can heal all the substance abuse and the dis-ease and the illusions of scarcity that are having its way with us. And we could move into, like, a magnificent experience that is so worthy of who we are. You know, this, I talked to you a little bit about conflict. We come with conflict. And conflict, when we're with our brother in conflict, it looks like this. This is what conflict looks like. So when we recognize that we have it, this, and this is like, I want it my way, I want it my way, I want it my way. You're bad. No, you're bad. No, you're bad. So one of us has to be the bigger person. And to be the bigger person, we move from conflict into compassion. And this is what compassion looks like, coming open, undefended, and willing. And when we come to that conflict with compassion, this is what it looks like. And then we get to hold that child that's in pain, that believes it's in scarcity, that believes it needs to get its own, that there's not enough, and we get to just hold space for it and pour love into it. And soon enough, under the fertilizer of this compassion, this will begin to expand. It can't not. Love heals all. And this will continue to expand. It can't not. Love heals all. And it will expand and it will expand until finally you're standing with your brother and it's more like this. And it's holy, and that's where you get to see confidence. You know, you get to say, I'm good, you're good. We can stand with each other and support each other. And from this place, we can really see our optimal state on our own, you know, and recognize our optimal state on our own. Now, what I wanted to talk to you about today was Holy Communion. And Holy Communion goes beyond competence. Holy Communion goes into holy collaborations. And that's when I give up and you give up your own little agenda and my own little agenda, and we start to move like this. And then we start to move like this. And this is stronger than this. And this is stronger than this. This is when all of mine is all of yours is all of mine, and there's no limit. You know, so that's the optimal idea, and yet we're living it. Can you believe we're living in this sometimes? And not just with our brother, but in our own mind, we have so much internal conflict, you know, that is a call for what? Compassion. Like, look at those places that we've left uncared for and say, oh my gosh, that's just a call for love. I get to be compassionate. I get to be more compassionate in my food program, in my finances, in my physicality, in my romances, in my career. I get to be more compassionate, and I get to bring more love because obviously I can do that. That was the point of the talk that I was going to tell you, that I misread the book. Funny. You're like, substance abuse, that doesn't make sense, and that's why I wear glasses. So the idea of substance abuse didn't come from me, but when we're looking for answers and inspirations, you know, even the Holy Spirit can twist the words on a page to cause you to think outside the box, and that's amazing. Everything can be used for your highest good. Even when you think you made a mistake and took a wrong turn, it will lead you to a place, if you have complete faith in God, that is always going to be for your highest good, that this is for me. The ego runs around in the form and says, I need to be informed, I need to be informed, I need to be informed. And we drive ourselves crazy with being addicted to the current events, which are always going to change. We don't need to be informed. I know that sounds crazy. We need to be in love. And sometimes in love and informed are two different playgrounds. You know, and the ego wants to be informed and know. You know, and spirit just wants to be in love. And when you are in love, you know all you need to know. You know, ship goes down, we're going down in God. There's nothing outside of God. You know, for me, I'm here to cause conversations that will inspire revelations. I'm not here to tell you the current events. I'm here to create a birthplace for a possibility of greater caring and community where each member can feel self-expressed. And where we can hold the space for other people to feel self-expressed in the most optimal way. It doesn't require that we, you know, fill out forms or get in form or move in form. We let the consciousness inform the form. We work on the unseen side of things and we let the consciousness inform the form. And if we do that, the form will be perfect, even when we misread it. Isn't that awesome? So I wanted to close off with this one story, The Prodigal Son. It's interesting. It's a story about this person who thought, I don't have enough. And he's this son who's so well cared for by his father. They have a great house. They have servants. He has everything. And he says, from that place of want, and God bless him, because we all have this spirit of curiosity. And curiosity is awesome and should not be denied. But curiosity should always come from a place of, I want to know more from love, not, I want to get the hell out of this place. This place is a shithole. And that's how the prodigal son left. He was like, this place is done. I'm done with it. There's nothing here for me. I need my money, and I need to get out of here. And when I was a kid and I read that story, I thought, wow, he's so rude to his dad. Like, he was just like demanding of his father, give me my money and I'm out of here. Split it with my brother and let me be gone. So, but the father in the story is so compassionate. He's like, he doesn't argue at all. He like cuts the money in half and says, you know, goodbye. And kid goes off and he has what's called a wild living. And who doesn't love that? A little wild living, never hurt anybody. Again, like, did he come to the wild living from a place of curiosity and innocence and let me dabble in the colors I haven't been in before? Or does he come from it from like, I'm not enough and this is not enough and I'm always gonna have that disease of want with me and therefore I'm going to surely go down the drain with that experience of want? That, if you carry that experience of want, every single relationship you have is going to be fractured. So he ends up being completely fractured to the point where he has no money and he is hired out as a servant for another family and he's in charge to feed the pigs and he's so hungry he wants to eat the pig's food. And he has this revelation like, gosh, this is so bad. Like, I'm even being treated worse than the servants in my dad's own house. That at least my dad feeds his servants well. I'm gonna go home to my dad's house and I'm gonna tell him I'm a loser. I'm a complete loser. I'm so sorry. I was bad. I'm hideous. I'm deserving of nothing. Please hire me as your servant, and I will forever be the scum of the earth. And he starts to walk home to his dad, and his father sees him returning. And his father, he's walking home to his dad like this, like, I'm horrible. His father sees him in compassion. His father runs to him and says, kisses him on the cheek. And he says, you're home, you're home. And he celebrates with him. It's like, this is what we can do for each other. You lost your mind for a second. I'm not going to judge you by that. Like, you lost your mind for a second, but you're returning to love, to a greater idea of yourself. So he goes running out, gets the son, he says, get the ring on his finger, get the coat on his back, get the fatted cow, let's have a party. And the other son comes out and he's like, what the what? It's like, what's up, Dad? You know, like, I stayed here the whole time. I didn't go crazy in the wild living. And you never had a party for me. And his father's like, what, you've gone, like, this is your brother's come home. We thought he was dead. Like, we should celebrate him. So it's funny because that story is called The Prodigal Son. It should be called The Prodigal Sons because they both went mad. One went mad by saying, this isn't enough. And the other one stayed home and said, this isn't enough. Like, there was still not enough. And we do that. We lose our minds. We go, this isn't enough. And they have my good, Dad. God, did you not see that was meant for me? Like, you gave it to the wrong son down here. Like, come on. And God's like, wait, you have no idea how well I've blessed you. Like, turn the channel, because you have so much to be blessed for. And I have not forgotten you. And I have everything for you. So today, we get to experience the abundance that comes from us, not to us, but from us, to change the channel in the correct direction so that we can experience the opulent nature that we are worthy of, and so that we can share that opulent nature with everyone who comes over our nose, and we can begin to annihilate that illusion of scarcity. Because it has no business here. It has no business in my life. And I really would like you to be about the business of abundance. And if your friend gives you a book, you should probably return it. That's the word.